everyone, welcome to the second video in my website redesign series. In the first one, in the last video, which I'll link to on the playlist up there, we went through the sitemap, like planning the website, planning out exactly what templates I'm going to need to design and build, what pages I'm going to need. And as part of that, in that video, I mentioned that what I'm going to be doing first is making an MVP, which stands for a minimum viable product. I'm pretty sure is what it stands for. Basically, it just means it's the smallest possible version of the project that will still get the job done. And in my case, the job that needs to be done is, with my website, provide access to all of my content online, need to showcase my work, and also make it easy to contact me. So that's what we're going to be doing today, is designing and building the MVP of my website, which in my case is basically just going to be a single page. I'm going to be walking you through how I designed it and also building it live with you in Webflow. Well, not live, because I'm going to be editing this video, but you know what I mean. I actually kind of like when people have just one page websites. I think it's kind of minimal and cool, and there's just like a blurb about them and like, yeah, links off to their stuff. So that's what I've decided to go with for this MVP of my website. I recorded my screen as I went through the design process, but as you can see, as you watch it, I pretty much already had an idea in mind of exactly what I wanted to do. I definitely did try out a few different versions and like explore a couple of different arrangement ideas for this text. But for the most part, the idea was pretty solid before I started. I was originally thinking about having it be a white page with some like colored links or something to bring some colored accents in there. But then I thought, you know what? It's my website and I really like pink and purple. So why not just have a pink and purple gradient as my background? I tried it with a photo, but it didn't really work, and I decided it wasn't incredibly important at this stage either. So this is what I've ended up with as the page that I'm going to be building today. It's just a plain pink and purple gradient in the background. A logo up the top, and that logo is actually going to be animated. There's some very simple text that just explains who I am, what I do, and links off to the relevant stuff. For my work, for the check out my work link, I'm going to be linking to my Dribbble profile instead of a portfolio. Then at the bottom, there's links to all of the socials and the stuff and the places to find me. So it'll serve that purpose of, yeah, access to my content, access to contact me and see my work, but without too much like design and development work at this stage. It'll be a good placeholder while I work on the rest. So what I'm going to do now is start screen recording and building this in Webflow. I'll be honest, I have not really used Webflow all that much before. In fact, I filmed a video of my first impressions and I've not used it much since then. So it's going to be a learning curve to go through, but I'm excited to get stuck in and get to know it better. And I think that a small project like this is a great place to start. So let's dive in. All right, so this is a new Webflow project, and I know that to start it, I need to add a container. And actually, first I should style the body with the gradient, shouldn't I? So let's figure out how we do that. Cool, that was pretty easy. This is already looking better than a plain white page. I went to a Webflow workshop at Epicurrents that was hosted by Ran, who runs the channel Flux. He went through like an introduction to Webflow and using it, and a lot of what he said, like, it really clicked with me that this is not a website builder in the sense that you're just like dragging stuff around on screen and it'll make the code for you. You're still thinking about regular HTML and CSS structure and how that, you know, you'd put it together if you were coding it by hand, but it's just that this makes it a whole lot easier. So with this container here, instead of just dropping the logo straight in, what I would generally do if I was building myself is put it in a div block. So that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna add a class to this div because I think that was another one of the mistakes I made when I was doing that first impressions, is that I was kind of just building all over the place and I wasn't creating classes as I go, which if I was coding by hand, I would be doing. So I'm gonna call this one logo. And then on logo, I'm going to add some margin to the top. Okay, to style this H1, I would hope that I don't have to add a class to it, and instead, if I just style it, it'll apply to all H1s on the page, even though there's only gonna be one. But yeah, I would assume that's how it works. So that's what I'm just gonna go with. I need to work out how to host my web font. If I take advanced, I think there's something else I need to come back to. We'll just go with Arial for now. But the font I've used in my design is Averta, which is my fave. It's from the Designers Foundry, and yeah, I use it in pretty much everything, so I'm sure you've seen it before. Let's test that theory here. If I style this paragraph text to be white. When I add another paragraph, will it be white? No. There we go, got it. Okay, so if you want to style all of the thing on the page and not accidentally create a like random class for it, you have to select it so that it's all paragraphs, all H1, I guess. One thing you have to make sure of is that you're dropping your block in the right place. See how if I put it here, it'd be outside of the container. So I gotta make sure that there's the place to drop it. Okay, so I want this guy to be like pinned to the bottom of the screen. And I feel like I know how to do this in code. So let's see if we can figure it out here. Yeah, there we go. Absolute. And then, is this the one to put? Maybe it's this one. Zero. There we go. Cool. That's not exactly what I want though, is it? I feel like I'm gonna have to do some CSS research. But anyway, let's keep adding stuff. So, for these guys here, I want them to be SVGs because I want to be able to change the hover state, like change the color on hover. I'm gonna make them go a dark purple, I think. I was doing a bit of research about it before, come across this guy here, so yes, I have to embed the SVG code rather than upload it as an image file. Let's see how to go about doing that. So, I'm guessing I take an HTML block somehow, embed, there we go, that's probably it. Let's put it in here. Now I use a tool called, actually I can never remember if it's OMG, SVG, no it's SVG, OMG. Okay, so this is the tool that I use to compress SVG files. Oh, what am I doing? I can't like navigate my computer and talk at the same time. Okay, so I like using this because it just compresses them a little bit and gets rid of like things like the title, stuff like that, so yes. And then I can just go to markup actually and hopefully you just copy it straight from here. Let's see. If I add this in. Cool, there we go, we've got it. I wonder if I can label this thingy though. No, doesn't seem to be. Okay. That's all right. I do want to put a class on it though. Because then I can just change the hover state on that class and hopefully it should apply to all of them, like logically thinking. Let's call this social icon. Makes sense, right? Oh, hey, I just realized that you can just use the undo key in Webflow. That's kind of nice. I, you know, just did it out of habit and it worked. All right, we'll solve that problem later. I'm just gonna get all of my icons sitting in this space for now. I'm wondering, see how the fill is embedded in the code here? I'm wondering if that perhaps shouldn't be like that. And I should instead just be doing that through the CSS, but I guess we'll find out. When I work on our marketing website, we use IcoMoon as to generate an icon font. So usually for small SVGs and things like this, I would just use that because then you just change the color of text and it changes the color of the icon because the icon is the font, if that makes sense. All right, now all the pieces are in there. I guess I should add the links as well because that's like something else that I need to style. I know I had trouble with links last time styling them, so let's see how we go. Right, make this a link. Here we go. This, just like the paragraphs, I think this was my problem last time as I didn't select all links to style. So that's what we're gonna do. So our links are going to be, why is it telling me that it is white when it is actually purple? I hope this does the hover for all links too, that would be ideal. Okay, we have a rogue dark purple link, and I don't know why it is doing that. Okay, it looks like maybe this is a bug. So what we're gonna do is... Boom, that worked. Cool, okay. This is why you gotta love forums. Right, so I'm gonna put a bottom border on all of my links. I don't like doing an underline because I feel like it sits too close to the text, and I think, yeah, I don't know, a bottom border just looks a little bit more sleek. So we're gonna have it solid. It's gonna be one pixel, and it's gonna be white. I also really like adding a transition onto links and things like that because I just think it eases in and it looks really nice. So we're gonna transform the border color. Yep, and we're also going to, can I add another one? So you know when I hover, like, does them kind of cool? Yeah! Okay, for this content block, how do I make sure I select that? I think I can go in here and go content, there we go. I put a percentage on the height, but I think I'm gonna actually do it based on the viewport. Because that way, when I shrink up the page, yeah, that'll change too. Okay, should we do the easy thing first? Should we figure out how to make these things change color? I don't know why I think that's easy, but I did have a tutorial about it, so let's try and follow this here. I guess the first thing to do is make this guy a link. And I would guess that the best way to do that, I'm probably gonna have to edit in this HTML file here. Okay. So now that this is a link, it of course has that underneath because we set that to go on all links, so it's got an underline. But I'm gonna set social icons to have a border bottom of none. No, that's what I need to do. I think I need to go to link within social icon. Looks like this is gonna be another one of those things that I'm adding to my to solve later list. Ooh, interesting. Let's try this. Yeah, birdie, we got it. So because I want the colors to go the same as the link colors do, it's easy. All that I'm dealing with is that border issue. That's okay, we'll sort that out. Now that that one's sorted, let's move on to this issue of this footer thing not doing how I want. I know I've coded this before, I'm sure it's easy, I've just forgotten how. So anchor footer to bottom of page. This is a tip for coding. If there's something you want to do, you can be pretty sure there's like a Stack Overflow or a code pen, a CSS tricks or something that explains how to do it. So you just gotta like type in the right thing into Google basically. Okay, I've gotten somewhere. I forgot, silly me, that Webflow uses Flexbox, which is a pretty great, like, you know, modern CSS framework. I don't know if that's the right word, and I'm sure all the code people will tell me I'm wrong for it. But Flexbox is pretty great because it helps you with alignment and things. How I did it was I found this tutorial from one of the Webflow, like, training videos, I guess is the word I'm looking for, which helped me do exactly what I was trying to do. So there we go, that's great. So just to walk you through it, in case this is something you're having trouble with too, here's what I did. So, first of all, my container has flex display on it now. Rather than being display block, it's display flex, set to vertical, and set to space between, so that, like, the top thing will go at the top, and the bottom thing will go at the bottom, if that makes sense. Then, my content block, which is, you know, this thing in the middle here with my text in it, I've set it to expand. And that means that, say, if I change it to this, which is the regular setting, expand means that it will fill in any extra space in between, like, either side of this item. So, basically, it adds space at the bottom and at the top to push the other things out to the end, which is great. So then if I shrink my page in, like, the footer is staying there, and it won't overlap it anymore either, which is ideal. I also added, so I put all of my like middle content stuff into its own div to like nest it in there. Made that a bit shorter because I was worried that my line length was a bit too long. And then I put a 20% of the view height margin on this thing just to like, yeah, be a bit more responsive. So as you shrink the screen up, this space shrinks a little bit too. Still not sort of the issue of these lines yet, but what I have done, because also remembering Flexbox, is I've made my footer to be display flex as well, and I've aligned the items to the center, so whereas before they were all hanging up the top here, so I mean, you couldn't really tell because of the lines, I think, but yeah, it looks better if they're all aligned with the center of the image. So really happy that I figured that out. Something cool about Webflow is that it's really easy to do the responsive styles. So I've just been clicking through here and changing things as needed. Here's an example. In my main desktop view, I have this content text block at 90% width, right? Because I didn't want it stretching all the way to the end. When I go into tablet view though, and then further down, I want it to be back to 100%. So I change it here and it applies to all of the breakpoints below it as well. So that's really handy. This is all looking good. Ooh, something an issue here though. I've made the heading smaller on mobile just because it was a little bit obnoxious, and I think I'm gonna make the paragraph text smaller as well. So let's remember to go to all paragraphs and shrink this guy down. But then if I go back up, you see the text gets bigger again. So handy. Yeah, solving this issue of targeting a link within a div, so rather than all links on the page. I know I could go through and just like, instead of having link styling across the board, I could make all these a class, like a text link class, and then apply it to all these links. But I don't think I should have to do that. There must be a way to target all links within a certain div. So yes, I have done what I always do when I get to a point that I'm stuck and I have asked for help, reached out to Webflow on Twitter. So gonna wait now and see what they say. Okay, I'm back, I figured it out, and it's a few days later, as you can probably tell by the fact that my hair is a lot more purple than it was in the last clip. So it turns out that targeting like a link or a heading or whatever within another class is not yet a feature of Webflow. But it was a pretty easy fix to just add a few lines of custom code in the project settings section of this Webflow project that I have. So I just wrote a few lines in there to take away the bottom border from the social icons and also from the logo as well, because I made that link to the homepage. Something else I did without screen recording it was set up some pages for the like static things that I have linked on my old website, so things like my portfolio review instructions, things like the form to download my screen printing guide, which is linked to from what I think is my most popular video. I didn't want those pages to be offline because I wanted people to still have that information and be able to access it, so I just made a really simple basic page that houses that information and yeah, takes over that URL so that it doesn't go to a 404 error. And with that said, this version of my website is now live, which is really exciting. I'm happy to finally have it out there, and it feels like that first step towards tackling this huge project that I have in mind. I hope you enjoyed seeing the coding process of it, as I suspected. It was a really good, simple little project to get back into using Webflow and just get used to it and how it works, learn some things as well. So if you're wanting to learn Webflow yourself, perhaps making yourself a single page site could be a really good place to start. I've put a link in the description to where you can try Webflow out. It's free to just get in there and have a play. You have to pay if you want to host the project or export the code, but yeah, if you just want to get started using it and seeing what you think, then you can dive in. If you did enjoy the second video in my website redesign series, then please give it a thumbs up and let me know down below in the comments what your favorite part of this video is, if there was, I don't know, a particular thing you learned in it, or maybe something I did wrong that you think I need to learn. Maybe you can share that down below in the comments. Next up in the series, we'll be tackling the bigger website project, and I'll be starting to wireframe out the pages that I planned that I need in my sitemap video, the first video in the series. So stay tuned for that. I think it should be a good one. I'll be taking you through my thought process when I'm in those initial stages of designing a web page, and in this case, designing multiple web pages and how elements might, you know, transfer across them. So look forward to that, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.